Hi, this is Nahi Kazaza, and I'd like to welcome you to the video of our Leveraging Habits and Routines Best Practices Forum that we had in March of 2017. We started the class out right away by having people do an exercise. And in the exercise, we had people compare something that they had a really good system or routine for with something else that they thought perhaps they could have a better system or routine for. And the idea was to get people to really think about the experience of having a routine compared to the experience of not having a routine, and also really think about what the impact on your life is, or how it affects you to have a routine or system for something compared to how it affects you when you don't have a routine or a system for something. So here is a sampling of our round robin and the resulting discussion. And if you'd like, you could stop the video right now and maybe do the exercise for yourself as well.
Exercise is that I want you to think of something, and it can be at home or at work, something that is kind of a routine or a habit to you that you just sort of do on autopilot, and it really serves you well that you do that. And then what I'd also like you to do is think of something that maybe you'd love to have routine, you know, kind of in a routine and on autopilot, but you don't. And I'm going to have you compare the two. So I'll just give you a minute to do that really quick. So
maybe. Sure. Two things that I systemize very well. One at home is I structure my exercise time. So if I think to myself I should exercise, that would never happen. But because I do it at 5:30 in the morning, 4 days a week, and then 6 a.m. on Saturdays, and then I do something else on Tuesdays, it just gets done, and it's not painful. I don't worry about whether or not I should do it. The other thing that I'm really good at in my business is accounts receivable. Mm-hmm. But I suspect that's because I have a time and billing program. Boom, you push a button, there's the accounts receivable. But I also have a mindset where I look at all my accounts receivable every Friday if I haven't earlier in the week. So I just don't have to worry about it. Mm-hmm. The thing I wish I could structure better is follow up on what I call PCs, which for me are potential clients. Mm-hmm. Because it used to be that everybody, I love my planner, I love my writing. So it used to be people would call and I would have notes on it, it would be easy to follow. But now most people email. And so do I print out the email from the potential client? Do I line them up? How do I capture them in one place mm-hmm. so that it gets done? Mm-hmm. There's no structure. It feels too scattered.
Yeah, okay, great. And so then when you compare those two and you think about if you had the system for the PC, what would be different for you, do you think?
It'd be much, it could just, this way I try to capture them at the end of the month, it's really too late. Mm-hmm. I would need something where I kept more of a running log. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and what I love about what you shared is the difference in the experience. So something like exercise is a great example. Right? When you have it structured, so you're just doing it the same way, you're not even thinking about it. It gets done, but it's an important thing that's getting done. But if you don't have it structured and you have to actually, in your brain, think about it, it doesn't get done a lot of time. What about you, Mary?
For me, my bills, personal and business, I do them once or twice a week, depending on what's going on, but I just know that that's what I need to do, mm-hmm. and then I put together my plan for the next time I sit down, so I already know when I'm sitting down what I'm going to do, mm-hmm. so that's easy. What sounds really funny is that my vitamins, and I have to take certain medicine every day, mm-hmm. that if I don't take it, my numbers come, mm-hmm. they get out of center, mm-hmm. and so when I have like a more advanced vitamin routine or supplementation routine, I'll screw up my regular medicine and then I get in trouble with my doctor. Mm-hmm. It's pretty funny because my numbers go up. Mm-hmm. Like, but that's part of my life, so I kind of have to accept it. What do I do when I have more that I have to do to actually keep myself healthy and strong?
Mm-hmm. So you have a simple medicine routine, but then when you have the complex vitamins, if you can get that in a routine too, then everything would be moving smoothly.
Yeah.
But if you don't have the routine, then the numbers go crazy. And
yeah, and then I stick this stuff on the counter and I'm like, well, that's really ugly. It doesn't need to sit there. But then I have to put it there because then I, so I can remember to do it.
Well, I struggle to find something that was a routine or a habit that serves me well. Except eating and sleeping. But then when you started talking, I realized that I book my exercise class, and if I don't show up, I lose that class, and that means I lose money. Mm-hmm. So if I book it in advance, then I know I have to attend. Mm-hmm. Regardless of what happens in my life, I will be there. And so I realize that that's the one thing that does serve me well. So thank you for the hint. The one thing that I would like to, which is what you and I have been working on, mm-hmm. is the focus concentration time. Mm-hmm. And I have been working on it since we last spoke. And today was my first success.
Yay!
When I went to breakfast and sat there with a cup of coffee and some food and just started writing what I needed to talk about. And oh my gosh, I got so much clarity mm-hmm. on that particular issue. It was wonderful.
So once you start doing that yes. over and over again and repeatedly, and you notice the amazingly strong impact it has on your clarity the rest of the day and your confidence and then just how you go about, then you will never let it go, just like that exercise class, because the consequence will be as painful as losing the money, right? Yeah. But the consequence will be in terms of kind of feeling confused and muddled all day. Yeah. But I'm so excited that you
Well, now I need to book it.
Yes.
So
yes.
now I need to put it on my calendar mm-hmm. and just put it there.
And yes, do it. And do it as many, if you can do it every day,
yes,
even better.
Yes.
Excellent. Jenna, what about you?
I have a couple things that serve me pretty well. One is the exercise mm-hmm. routine. It's just becoming ingrained and it's a habit and I mm-hmm. miss it. Mm-hmm. The other thing is cleaning. I don't like to clean all at once, so mm-hmm. I typically will break it up into 4 days mm-hmm. and spread it out so that it's a lot more palatable.
Mm-hmm. And do you have a kind of a system for it?
I do. Like one day I'll do the dusting and wiping down the picture frames because I do an extensive cleaning every other week. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, one day maybe the bathroom, and another day, you know, it'll be something else. And so by the end, you know, and then vacuuming, and so by the end of the 4 days, I'm done. Mm-hmm. And then I don't have to worry about it.
Do you want to come to my house?
Yes. It works a lot easier, you know, because I just do it. It may take me a half an hour to an hour every single day. And then
it's done.
It's done, but it's much easier to do it when it's in small chunks.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, like my laundry. I love that.
Yeah.
So, and do you have one that you kind of want to get systemized?
Maybe just organizing, like, emails and, mm-hmm. you know, different things. And I tend to keep track of things in a lot of different ways, just to kind of as a fail safe, and I don't know if it's the most effective or not, but I'll have a calendar on the side of the fridge, I'll have another written calendar like a Franklin, mm-hmm. you know, in another area. Sometimes I'll keep things on track on my phone, mm-hmm. Sometimes on the computer, and so everything's kind of disjointed, but what I find is that it sort of covers, if I don't look at one thing, then you know, I'm looking at another source. And
so you have a lot of tools to kind of help you
yeah.
decide what
yeah.
to do next. Excellent.
Yeah. So, but it's not as probably good as it could be.
Okay, so today we'll figure out ways to get it to the next
yeah.
level.
Okay, so systems that I think are working pretty well for me are receivables, because mm-hmm. I also have it automated, like Susie, I did that with them. You know, and then if people are late, you know, we have a process in place on how to give notices and things mm-hmm. like that. So I think that's good. I'm also a time blocker, so mm-hmm. I think that I time block the night before for the day, the next day, and then I also time block for the next month mm-hmm. as well, as much as I can. Things that I need help on are definitely like content marketing. You know, just mm-hmm. getting that consistent. Getting that information out. I have a problem with exercise, and like you guys, you gals, with having that set in place. So I need to really have something like that in mm-hmm. place as well. And not feeling, and the other thing that I need help with is just not feeling guilty when I'm having interruptions from staff and mm-hmm. stuff. Because I want to be there for people, mm-hmm. but I need to get work done and not get irritated, you know. So that's one thing that I need to work on, systematizing.
Yeah, and there actually is a system for that too, which is kind of similar to what Barbara and I are working on. So I'm not going to put Frank and Dawn on the spot just because you didn't get the intro, but welcome Frank and Dawn and everybody else. And let's talk about what we're going to do today. So essentially we have, I'm reading more and more about the brain and kind of how we think. And one thing that's really interesting about how we think and how we operate in the environment is actually really good for us. It's really efficient. But we have a couple of different parts of our brain. And one part of our brain sort of works very, very quickly and with very little energy. And 80% of the day, we can pretty much do things on autopilot. So once it learns something, then you're just doing it the same way. You're not having to think about it. But what it's programmed to notice are exceptions and surprises. So essentially, what works about that is that you can, driving is a great example. So you can be in your car and not even think about it, but as soon as there's something surprising, like a car getting a little bit too close to you, or the traffic just acting weird, you immediately sort of wake up, become alert, and you kind of have a lot of adrenaline there, and you manage that surprise. So, but it's very efficient for the brain, because when you have to think and manage and make decisions, it actually takes a lot of energy, and it's just as much energy as a physical workout. So what your brain tries to do is figure out the lay of the land so that as much as possible during the day, you're noticing familiar patterns and you're able to sort of move around on autopilot so that you're reserving all that mental energy for when something is new, something that you have to learn, something that's a surprise that you have to deal with, that sort of thing. So when you think about this and you think about going through your day, and how many of you have ever felt that kind of overwhelmed or discombobulated feeling when your head gets cloudy and it's harder to think, right? Because we've got so much going on. So the thing that I wanted to talk about today is, okay, so if we know this about our brain, what if we capitalized on it? And how could we capitalize on it? Well, one of the ways we can capitalize it is our take all the things that could be automated and automate them to the degree that we can, so that we are consciously reserving that energy in our brain for the decisions we want to make, for the things that are different each day. So there's some things each day that you're always going to want to be completely focused on. So for me, it's my coaching calls, my one-on-one coaching calls, right? I want to be 100% coach. Now there's part of that that's automatic, because you know there's sort of like catching up in the beginning. There is a rhythm to it since I've done it so long, and I can tell you that my coaching calls take a lot less energy now than they did in the beginning, because now that I have this rhythm, there's a familiarity with me and the person, there's the getting to know you part, there are questions that sort of come automatically because there are patterns to it, but still there's that focus, there's that complete focus. And so it used to be, if I had 4 or 5 coaching calls, then I was just dead, you know? And so you could not have any more than 5 during the day. And it's just now, after doing this for maybe 15 years, that I could do, you know, 6 or 7 in the day if I wanted to, and I probably still wouldn't be dead by the end of that. But it, so there's certain things also that we learn, like driving. So when you're driving the car in the beginning, it probably takes a lot of energy and you're really exhausted. But then once you get going on autopilot, you could drive forever and you don't really notice too much, unless you're driving in really difficult traffic. Now that's a completely different driving experience than if you're driving on the open road, right? Okay, so what we're gonna talk about today are things that we can automate. So for work, I wanna just start with a few things that we've said. So the accounts receivable process. I love that two of you said that the accounts receivable process is one that you actually have systemized, because I can say some of the business owners I've coached that do not have an accounts receivable process, a lot of the angst that they experience in their businesses, oh, my client hasn't paid me, but I'm really uncomfortable making that phone call. I'm not sure when to make the phone call. I'm not sure what to say, because I don't, you know, they're my client and I don't want to say it wrong because I really want to keep that good relationship. And, but now I've procrastinated and so much time's gone by. Now I feel bad that I haven't even sent the bill, you know, because, and I actually had somebody once that didn't give me a bill when I was in corporate America. Someone, we had a consultant, and he didn't give me a bill until maybe a year after he had done. He said, oh, I had some personal issues and I forgot to bill you, and so this is for what we did a year ago, and I'm just going, really? So, you know, at some point you're like, well, should I even send the bill? And so there's all this angst, and that's what we're trying to get rid of, is that angst and that stress and that, should I do this? Should I do that? Should I do this? Other one on the personal side that I really wanted to jump on is the working out, but we should put exercise. We should put taking medicine. I heard that one. We should put house cleaning. And cooking's one too, right?
Yeah.
I have a client who every Sunday, she actually hires somebody, it's a niece of hers, I think, to go to the store and buy the food and do all the prep for the food for the week. So let's say she's gonna have chicken breast, right? Then maybe she has a way that she prepares it, and she has it in the oven, and it's all chopped up in little pieces, and now it's in the refrigerator, so if she wants to make the chicken salad, she just grabs the salad, the chicken, throws it on, and there's her dinner. So she doesn't have to think about it during the week. So kind of food and food prep, good. Okay, who else has some ideas of things that would be great to have systemized?
Someone said Bill can personal.
Oh yeah, yeah, good one.
I know when it comes to food prep, one thing I do every Sunday is I do my shopping and my veggies and what you're talking about in essence, and, right? And then I wash and prepare everything and get it into my fridge, because now I know that I'm much more likely to eat it and eat well. Otherwise, I'm going out or I'm eating less healthy.
But whatever you can find, right? Whatever you can grab.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, good. What are some other work ones that would be really good? So someone said
following up
with potential clients. And it's interesting that you say that, because one of the ones that I had in my, I would really be great if I had this a system for this, was following up with networking contacts. So I just sort of do that arbitrarily, but I used to teach a networking class, and one of the things I would always say in the networking class is 90% of business cards that get exchanged at networking events never get followed up on.
So now we're going through a process of brainstorming, where as a group, we're thinking about as many examples as we can of things that we could automate, both at home and at work. And I may have cut this part out, but there are times in the discussion when I refer to how do you decide what's a good candidate for something to automate? And there's sort of the obvious criteria, which is anything that you do repeatedly. And of course, you're going to get more benefit if it's something that you want to do several times a week, for example. But there's also a less obvious criteria for systemizing, which is anything that you have a way of doing. And what is surprising is that often with very creative activities that you would never think that you would have a system for, maybe things that you've spent a lot of time learning, like playing piano, or in my case, I gave an example of a coaching call, you wouldn't necessarily think of that as a candidate for systemizing until you actually ask yourself, do I have a way of doing this? And when you realize that you actually do have a way of doing something, you realize that you really do have a system. And that can be really beneficial because it helps you do that thing better overall. And you'll hear me give an example of that somewhere in the session as well. Because the conversation meanders a bit, I thought it would also be helpful to give you an idea of what the flow is of the class. So we did the initial exercise in the beginning. Then I talked a little bit about the concept of how our brain works and why doing this gives us so much more mental clarity and emotional equanimity, as well as physical energy. And then we're doing what we're doing now, which is brainstorming on anything that could be automated. And then what you'll see me doing as we wrap up this brainstorming process is having people start thinking about, well, how do I want to apply this to my individual life? So I'll be asking people to think about how they want to add systems, maybe what systems they want to add. And I'll also leverage the knowledge in the group by having a few people share examples of things that they do have systemized really well so that other people in the group can take advantage of that. And that's one of the things I love about these best practices forums. Then at the end, I'm going to have people write a draft of a system that they'd like to start working with right away, and I'm going to do a final round robin, but some of this won't be on the videotape. So I'll tune in with you again as we get to the end of the class.
So let's come up with some more things that we think that we would like to systemize. Let's focus on work. So we have the accounts receivable process. We have potential client follow-up. What else?
I have to do a lot of one-on-ones with mm-hmm. people that report into me.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm trying to systemize it and actually have an agenda for it rather mm-hmm. than just say, okay, tell me what's going on.
Yeah, so would we call those mentoring meetings maybe?
Yeah, I suppose we could call them that. Yeah, they're actually my direct reports, so mm-hmm. we call them touch base meetings.
Okay. So, one-on-ones with direct reports. One-on-one, but they're regular one-on-one mm-hmm. touch base meetings with our direct reports. What else at work? Yes.
where I work, we have what we call handoff meetings. So what that means is from marketing to production, operations. Mm-hmm. And there's... This goes into the culture of the company I won't go to. There's a checklist that we like to use that identifies to make sure we haven't missed anything so that there's a smooth transition from marketing to operations.
Mm-hmm.
It's valuable for us internally to have something we can go to and to go down a list of step-by-step processes to
we know that we're checking in on everything.
Yeah, we're checking in on everything so that we don't have to come back a week later and someone has to call us like a project manager and say, what about this, what about that?
That's right. So let's call those handoff meetings. I think that's great. Handoff from one department to the next. Handoff meeting. Oh, yeah. And Dawn's like one step ahead of me there where she's got the checklist down there because we're going to talk about the various ways that you can systemize, and one is a checklist, right? Okay. So what else?
We use checklists for hiring people
mm-hmm.
so that we have all their training listed. Mm-hmm. We know exactly when they have it done, when they've been given their equipment, what their equipment is. And we also have one for terminations
mm-hmm.
so that we've taken their key. We make sure that every single thing that we need to take back from them is done.
Okay, so
people have walked off with laptops.
Oh.
Our fault, not theirs. We never thought to ask.
Hiring and training, and you know, when you first said hiring, I thought the interview process, so we should add that maybe, the interview process, because the hiring is also like the assimilation, right?
Mm-hmm.
So assimilate in, interview, train, and termination, so processes with people. What else?
Well, I think my marketing, the part that I really need to do is to
mm-hmm.
you know, anything that social media, you
mm-hmm.
know, just things like that can be definitely systematized.
Mm-hmm. So marketing, social media. We have a process at Aspire. You guys probably are the recipients of this process, which is that we send out articles on a regular basis. And I'll tell you, there's years when I haven't sent an article out for a whole 8 months. I actually had somebody on my staff do a trigger. Because what my problem is I just wouldn't get started. And she would do a trigger, and so I would get an email that says, it's time for you to write an article. And if I had an idea, I would just write it right then, the first draft, and send it. And then she'd look at it, and we'd have a little thing going. But if I couldn't think of what to write on, then I would say, what should I write on? Any ideas? And then she'd give me a couple ideas, and then that would get the juices flowing. And then if that didn't, just get, you know, then there's another thing. But there was actually a process, and now I would say we're pretty good at getting an article out every other week or so. Every once in a while, we'll skip a few weeks, but the system doesn't have to be religiously adhered to. If it's adhered to 80% of the time, you're getting a tremendous amount done, and we are getting a tremendous amount of really good articles written, I think. Okay, so marketing.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
I don't know how to articulate this other than, like most of us, there's those 500 plus LinkedIn contacts
mm-hmm.
that we really don't know very well, and what should we do with them, and are there things we should post on LinkedIn? But clearly there's people that we can be in touch with. Just I don't even know what to do with them.
Yes, you and I have to have a powwow on that because that's exactly a problem that I have
when
too.
When you do, let me know.
Okay, maybe we ought to do a LinkedIn thing, but we need someone that knows
right.
how to handle all those LinkedIn. in context. So we'll plan that maybe for August, because I've got the topics planned. But you know, what to do with your LinkedIn contacts, how to build relationships with your LinkedIn contacts. So that would be maybe going on the title of a social media, but yeah, so good. What about email? I haven't heard anyone say anything about email. Ah, you were gonna say it, okay. So email. So I have a little bit of the system for, and the system is that I scan my emails and then I do this weekly, but then sometimes I don't. So about four times a year, and this is one of those times, I just let it go. And then I let it go usually for a couple months. And when I mean say let it go, I mean, it doesn't mean that I don't read them. What it means is I let them stay in the inbox. And
why? Right.
Huh?
Why?
Not on purpose.
Well, you call them unreaded.
When I'm good, every single week I have an email cleanup day. And on my email cleanup day, it's only like an hour or so, but I go through and I know exactly how to sort the emails the best way. And then, you know, I'm dealing with all the ones I haven't dealt with, and the rest of them go into their platforms, and it's just wonderful. And I get this great shoot of dopamine in my brain every time I see the inbox that's empty and it says, we have nothing to show you here. And I think that my first time I did that was, I got that system down was maybe December of a couple years ago, and I remember putting a Facebook update up that said, hey, do you know what your email says, folder says, when it's empty? I do. And my husband was so mad because he thought I was rubbing it in people's faces. But I was just so excited that I actually had an empty email inbox. So, email. What else? But who else? You know, other email systems.
Yeah. Well, maybe to piggyback off of the email, we have a contact relationship management tool. And there's a schedule, there's a calendar, mm-hmm. that every morning, that's one of the first things I look at, is who am I supposed to call? Mm-hmm. And if I don't, what happens is I look at the month previous, at the end of the month, and I'll look at, oh geez, 2 weeks ago Thursday, there's a whole list of people I needed to call. And that's when priorities pop up, and I have to take care of things. And so there's, to me, I guess, a system for me to go back and revisit things, people on my calendar from a marketing standpoint. Maybe calling people, maybe doing other tasks that I just didn't get to.
Mm-hmm.
So I've been doing it lately at the end of the month, looking and going back over the whole month and saying, what did I get to?
Mm-hmm.
And kind of day by day, kind of just time blocking, as someone said, going through that. But it's amazing how much I've overlooked. And it's just the day-to-day management has become sometimes crisis management, and then you overlook those things.
You know, that's such a good point, because we've gone to a day and age now where we cannot get done everything that we have to do every day. So we're always going to get more things to do. So we can't operate by the thinking principle that I'm just going to get everything that I have to get done today. So we have to operate more on the 80-20 rule. So what's the top 20%? So there's always going to be something that's in the bottom 80% that doesn't get done in a given day. I love this idea of having a system to go back and look over the things that you didn't get to within a certain time frame, and then reassessing if any of them are bubbling up to the top now. So that, what else? Something in your personal life?
Yard work for me, I don't know.
Yard work, for sure.
Unless you have a gardener, which I don't.
I was thinking about home improvement.
Yeah.
Home maintenance.
Papers? And what else?
Home maintenance.
Yeah, paperwork, filing at home. What else at home? So that probably covers it.
Maybe even personal development.
Mm-hmm.
Could be, or meditation, or
meditation.
You know, reading. You know, reading or personal development,
mm-hmm.
or something.
Financial planning. As much as bill planning, it's also
investing. So one thing I want to say, because
hobbies. Yeah. You know, if you say you want to learn how to play piano, maybe you should start.
Oh, no, but there was a while that there was a couple of us that were playing piano, practicing piano, and we would practice 10 minutes every day, even though you're supposed to practice, you know, maybe 20 minutes or 30 minutes, but this way we were going to get going every day. So, practicing an instrument or something is good to add there, Dawn. All right, what I want for you now, how you're going to take this and make it valuable, is to think about your own life. Having systems does not necessarily mean that you've got to structure your whole life. So I think some people avoid systems because they feel like they trap you. So I want to really clarify this point that some people love systems and they love having everything organized and structured and it makes them feel safe and organized and they may, like everything's in control. So if you're one of those people, then you're just going to love doing this. But if you're one of those more creative types that likes improvising and being and kind of doing what you want when you want to do it, you may find a little bit of resistance to the idea of systemizing too many things. But what I have found is that you can systemize to an optimum level, and you can systemize things that are really creative. And I'll give you an example on my group coaching calls, my group classes that I do. I do a lot of those. And so those are pretty much systemized, but they're an art. So I can never tell you how the conversation is going to go before it happens. I can never even tell you, you know, what issues are going to come up or how I do everything. And part of it is from learning. It's a skill from learning. But there is a system there. And it isn't a system I even wrote down necessarily. But I can tell you if I did write it down, then what I would probably say is that in the beginning, I always do some kind of a round robin. A lot of you have been on a lot of my calls, so you probably are familiar with this. So we do some sort of round robin in the end just to kind of get people engaged or introducing themselves in some way. Then we launch into the topic, and somewhere in there, I'm introducing the topic. And if there's a model, there's a model introduced. But then somewhere in there, we have people commenting and sharing stories about how they're relating to it, so people are relating to it. And then we get a discussion going, and I sort of loosen up, and I follow the discussion where it goes for a while. And then I notice the time, and I notice it's time to start wrapping up, so then we start doing our final round robins. And always in our final round robins, we're asking people to think about what's the most valuable thing that they got out of the session and how they're going to use it. So that's a system. And it is not something that stifles me in any way. And I never force myself to do a call that same way if I don't want to. If I want to do something different, if I don't want to start with round robin for that day, I just don't. So the system doesn't have to stifle you. But for each one of us, we're going to have a different optimal way of systemizing. So that's what I want you to think about now, is what would be the optimal way of systemizing for you?
A particular thing or?
Your life?
Is it the way or?
Right now what you're saying, what you're gonna answer, the question you're gonna answer is, what would I like to have systemized? So if I answered that question, I would say, you know what, in my personal life, I would do a lot better if I had my exercise systemized, if I had a little bit more of the house cleaning systemized. And I'm looking up here for ideas, that's why we do these lists. And I think my paperwork and filing, if I had that systemized. Everything else I think I'm okay on. Maybe the cookie. So I'm going to take four of those things and say, you know what, these four things, if I added them, it would make a huge difference in my life. You know, my work life, for sure, if I had a marketing process, really need to upgrade my email systems because I'm slipping, right? I love Frank's idea of kind of going back and, you know, following up. So you're getting some ideas from what people said here, but you're thinking, you know, what would I implement? What would I implement? So I want you kind of all to kind of think about what you want to implement that's going to make your life easier. And you all get to choose. And you don't have to systemize everything. Okay, I want to give you the benefit of the other people in the room. So I'm going to go through this list, and I'm just going to ask who has a good system and have you share it so we can all listen to the people that have great systems for these kinds of things. And we might have one or two shares. So exercise. We had a couple people that had great exercise systems. Susan, you have a great exercise system.
I do.
What is it?
I walk from 5:30 to 6:30 in the morning on Monday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. I do a weight class on Thursday from 7 to 8 a.m. And I do Tai Chi at the beach on Saturday morning from 6 to 8 a.m. And I just do it.
And And how did you get into that?
Well, the walking I've always done, I used to actually write it down. You know, when you stop writing it down, it's kind of hard for you.
Mm-hmm.
But it also helps with that. I've been doing it probably 12 years.
Mm-hmm.
About 8 years ago, one of the gals who works down the hall from me started joining me.
Mm-hmm.
So it's, you know, you don't feel like it's like, oh, I've got to make meetings. So you just do it.
Mm-hmm.
And for, the Tai Chi, I found I missed exercise on the weekends. I wasn't getting, and I get up at 5 a.m. anyway, and may as well just keep doing it.
Mm-hmm.
But I really feel better. In fact, on Sundays I give myself a break. But on Tuesdays I have a 7 a.m. Toastmasters group, so I don't walk in the morning because there's not quite enough time. And I find my energy drags.
Mm-hmm.
So I have to find something else.
So what I love about what Susan just said.
But I don't have to think about it.
Mm-hmm, is the two things. So once she got into the habit, she didn't have to think about it. But also she starts noticing how much of a benefit it is. And once you go through that part of the stage with your system, so at first it's hard to do, and it's hard to build the habit. But once you've built the habit, you start noticing how much better you feel. And it's not just exercise that produces a great feeling. We talked earlier about the 2 hours of focus in the morning and how much mental clarity that produces. So usually these systems are going to produce something for you that feels really, really good. And once you are doing it enough so that you're starting to experience the benefit, what happens is it becomes completely worth it to you, and the ratio changes, right? The effort ratio changes because it's becoming less and less effortful. It's taking less and less effort and energy because now it's becoming more of a habit. And so now it's going on autopilot, so you're spending less and less time and energy on it, but you're noticing the benefits more and more, and then when you skip it, you're noticing how it's not so much a benefit. So once you're able to kind of go through that shift, it's locked in. And that's why a system then can last for 12 years. Do you think that's someone?
No, just the linking things to others, you know, it's like that, the only way I have horrible with systems. I like to be free form, and then I have way too many decisions, so I like that. But the only way I can do it is like, okay, what do I do every day? Okay, I brush my teeth. So I have to link it to something. If I can't link it to something that is a regular thing, there's no gym.
Mm-hmm. Which brings up a point, and this is something that I was going to share with you in a minute, but since Dawn just brought it up, I think it's the perfect time to bring it up. And that is, what are some ways to add things to your systems that are really easy? Well, one is to tag them onto something that's already habitual. So like the brushing, the flossing teeth. So if I already have kind of a morning routine, if I add something into it, that's going to be a little bit easier to develop a new system. The other thing is things that drain you contain into small pieces. So my best example on that is my 10 minutes of laundry. Like laundry was just so draining for me, and then it would get piled up and I'd have 7 loads to do and I'd get through about 3 of them before I gave up. And so, but then when I said, oh gosh, 10 minutes I can fold and put away 1 load, it's only draining when I have 5 loads sitting up here that I'm trying to fold. And so when I got into that system of just containing it to 10 minutes, then what I could tell myself, and I've done that with other house cleaning chores, just kind of like what you did, just a half hour, an hour, and I'm done.
Yeah.
With house cleaning, it's really worked where, oh, well, I can get the kitchen done in 15 minutes. You know, when I tell myself that, then I just do it. And then it's done, and I get the benefit of that nice, clean kitchen. So containing things that drain you into small chunks and pieces and just do it more frequently, but just contain it. Writing the steps down. It's interesting, but there's a lot of things that we have that are systemized that we don't have written down anywhere. We've just sort of learned, like as we said, driving, and I talked about my calls. But one thing that I did last year is I wrote down my way of doing my coaching calls. And what I learned is that I could train mentors in the Aspire organization because I learned that I did have a way of doing it. But I didn't even know that I had a way of doing it. But then what happened is once I wrote down the way I do it, I wrote down my way of doing it, and then I started talking to people about my way of doing it, I got better at doing it. Because I knew my way of doing it. So it actually served me really well to just write down how I do it, even though I wasn't writing it to anybody but myself, and I already knew how I do it. So a lot of times we'll just say, oh yeah, I got it, I just do it in my head, but writing it down can help. Go for the same time of day, the same chain of events as frequently as possible. So when I'm trying to help people form habits, the frequency, because really what we're saying, we're thinking about a groove in your brain is like a little road, right? And the more steps that you have in the road, the more it just grooves in, grooves in, grooves in, right? So you're going to learn faster by repetition, which is why people memorize things. And you're gonna learn faster by repetition. And so if you can break things into smaller chunks and do them more frequently, and that's why, let's say you're having a horrible time with exercise, if you can do a 10-minute exercise thing 3 to 5 times per day, that is something that will get you going faster. And then you can maybe stretch it out, but you'll get the groove going. And then don't beat yourself up for not doing it the same way every time. Just whenever you notice, try to go back to it. This is important. I've noticed this myself with eating plans. So what I find is that when I try to eat a certain way and I have it all written down, when I notice myself screwing up, I start getting discouraged. I don't even know that I'm getting discouraged, but I am getting discouraged. So then once I notice screw up number one, I just forge ahead. But that screw up number two, screw up number five, I'm thinking I'm doing such a horrible job that I give up the whole thing. And what I've learned is that if I just am patient with myself and don't worry about it, because the way I learned that is by asking people, when have you successfully developed a habit? And every description of people who have successfully developed habits, they've never done it consistently the first time. And bad habits too. A bad habit is a great thing to look at, because you never immediately start a bad habit by doing it the same way every time, right? When you develop a bad habit, you sort of fall into it. You do it occasionally. And then you do it a little bit more, and then you do it a little bit more. Before you know it, it's a habit. That's the same thing with good habits. So you just, if you can approximate your system a few times and experiment with it, and then just do it a little more and a little more and a little more, what's going to happen is you're going to start that process of changing. Okay? All right. Let me see. Let's do it this way. Does anybody have any system on here that they have a great system for that they'd like to share? Let's see if we can have maybe 5 people share a great system that they have. Kristen.
So it took me 10 years to get there. but I finally put together a 1-week meal plan.
Mm-hmm.
And then once I put together the 1-week meal plan, I could put together the grocery list.
Mm-hmm.
And now every Sunday, not 100% consistently, but fairly consistently, I just go and I print out that grocery shopping list, and I go to my refrigerator, my shelves, and like, what am I missing? And it's just, it takes me minutes, and then I take that to the store, and it's been very freeing. And then I've not been as consistent of trying to do the food prep on Sundays for the week,
mm-hmm.
but I've been able to eat better, healthier, more consistently. Yeah. But it took me 10 years to get to that meal plan.
Well, mine is receivables.
Okay.
So we, and a little bit of payables, but the receivables, so we, whenever there's a change, so we get our payments in on the first of the month.
Mm-hmm.
And so on the 25th of the month, we send a reminder that your payment is due on the first of the month. And that's just every month we send that out.
Mm-hmm.
And if we don't get it by the first, and we use Google a lot, so we use Google Docs.
Mm-hmm.
And I have like a checklist on, this is the day it gets sent out, it's in the calendar. First of the month, if you don't receive it, the next day you get an email that you've got a late notice, and we actually do tack on a late fee.
Mm-hmm.
And then by the third day, if we haven't received it, then we already, you know, have an automated, you know, form that gets drafted and emailed over to, in our case, they're usually the tenants,
mm-hmm.
get emailed to them. And then we have a follow-up call. So I have it in our Google Docs that anyone can actually look at that file, and then they can actually see the procedure for
mm-hmm.
that. And then in terms of receiving, or actually changes, we'll say changes in the rate,
mm-hmm.
We do a 60-day, 30-day, and a 15-day reminder
mm-hmm.
to let them know ahead of time that there's going to be a rate change.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of that, what I find is I really like what you mentioned in terms of the checklist and documentation, even when I was first doing it.
Mm-hmm.
It's like I would document exactly what I would do because I said, you know what, I remember when I have to hire someone, you know, this is what they've got to do.
Mm-hmm.
And so it kind of helps also when you know that you need to get to that next hire in, because
mm-hmm.
at least then you have it all down pat exactly how you want them to do it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And then they perfect it. They mm-hmm. perfect to say, oh, well, this isn't really working for me, or can we do it a different way? And it kind of helps, in essence, to kind of assess and reassess.
Mm-hmm. I'd like to hear more about your email system.
My email system?
When it works? Okay. And how you started it. How long it took you to get to nothing in your emails.
So a lot of the success of my email system has to do with my folders. And it's you have to make decisions, and it's not a perfect system yet because I'm thinking there's probably some emails that I still run into the problem where I want to keep them in my inbox because I can't deal with them right now, but I don't want to forget, and I have to make decisions. And those I haven't figured out yet. But I have folders that are called client conversations and conversations with people in my network and things that I just don't want to throw away because I might have to refer back to at some point, but I don't want cluttering up the inbox. I'm not going to do anything with it. So what I do once a week is I go through my email and I sort it alphabetically by who the email's from, because half of the emails, unfortunately, are, you know, from Living Social or from LinkedIn or from Facebook or something like that. And so those I can delete right away. And then I have the people that I want to read. Like, a lot of us are subscribed to James Clear, right? I think we all kind of connected. But great blogger, has these really great little tools on habits and systems and being organized. And so there's certain things that I want to read, but I just can't read that. So I have a folder that says to read, and I throw them all in there. And then I'll have resources. Someone sends me something. Oh, Nahid, you might want to look at this. There's a resources folder. So I slide everything in the resources. And so what that does for me is I know if I want to find it, I know where I'll find it. So anybody who's on the Aspire team, there's a folder that says Aspire team, and any conversations that have happened with anybody on the Aspire team go there. The clients go in another folder. And then I actually have, for my clients that are actually sending me progress reports, I actually have a file for each person for their progress reports. So all the really important stuff, which is how they're doing on stuff, goes in there. So it's really the folder system. It's really just having a lot of folders, sort of being generous with the folders. Like I'll have, for my son, I'll have baseball, I'll have football. So I just have to re-engineer my thinking process and say, where would you look if you wanted this later and you didn't know where to find it? Well, I would look under baseball because it's gonna go under baseball. But because I buy so many things online, I have something called receipts and all my online receipts. But then the software that comes, there's one that says software because they'll send you a little executional file with a link that you have to, you know, go into to download it, because if my computer crashes, I'm gonna need all those. And some of those, if my computer crashes, I'm gonna need them. I also have an admin file and I take those emails and I don't have them in the email system. I copy them and I put them in. So since I have a file folder system, that's the crux of it. Once I figured out the file folder system, then it's a matter of everything sorted alphabetically and then things just get folded, really just swiped, either deleted or swiped into the file. And the goal is nothing in the inbox. So yeah.
To add to that, I use flags, like mm-hmm. say something's urgent, but it's not urgent right now.
Mm-hmm.
So my old preference would be to just let it sit there, because if I see it, I'll deal with it. I'm mm-hmm. very visual. And so you can still put it in your folder, but if you flagged it and then you hit, usually like I run on an Apple, my flags,
mm-hmm.
it'll all go into one place.
Mm-hmm.
So I just looked at it the other day. It's a newer system for me, and I was like, wow, those are two things I missed that I needed to do. Cool.
Mm-hmm.
And then I handled them, and then I clear the flag, and then it stays in the folder. So you can still have it, but you're...
I was thinking about that, and that's a great thing to add. See, I love this, so we can add routines on the receiver. I would add Mary's, which is, because I'm a little bit scared the flagged ones that I can't deal, I have to deal with, but I'm just like, are you going to come to this event? Well, I kind of want to, but so the flags, I love that. Go ahead and fold them, you know, put them in the folders, but then you have a way that you can call up everything that's flagged, right?
Yeah.
Anywhere in your email box.
Yeah.
See, and it's funny, I was just thinking, wouldn't it be great if the flags came in red, yellow, and green?
Well, they do.
On Outlook, they do. Yeah, and it helps
you
have a lot.
Categories in Outlook, you
yeah.
can even color code them.
Yeah, you can color code them. And you have a couple things, you know, different colors. You can change, you know, half one color, half the other.
Okay.
Yeah,
because you know when you right click, it's just it defaults to red, but you can
change it. You can change it so you have two different color codes depending upon how you're organizing.
My challenge is I have hundreds of folders. I have an insane file structure in my email, and I guess my fear is I do use the flag to like okay, I can't get to it right now, but I don't want to forget it, and I have too many of those. But yeah, my fear is if I file it. I mean, I know I can bring it back, but yeah, I have a fear of putting it in the folder and forgetting about it and not thinking to pull up my flag items.
Yes, see, that is an issue, and that's why we need Frank's system, which is the system where you go back. And I was thinking, not only do I need to go back and do all my files, but you need a time of day, right? So usually for me, it's Thursdays. So Thursday, you know, I allocate a couple hours to just slam through email and clean it. But then I think what I would like to tack onto that process is slam through email, clean it, then bring up the flags. But then I think the thing I'd like to add is because Thursdays is a kind of a quiet day, I would like to then bring up the to reads. Because then what I like to do on Thursdays is read the things that would be educational, because I always get behind on the reading because the reading always seems so indulgent. So, but all the articles that would be useful, watch the little YouTube videos, that kind of thing. So I think I would clean the email box, look at the flags, handle those things, and then the reward is getting to read the articles and look at the resources and play and watch the YouTube videos. Okay, so to wrap up, what I want each of you to do is write a system right now. So I want you to look at what you wrote on your wish list. And what I'd like to do is have you, we're going to actually take 5 minutes. And I want you to pick one thing that you would love to systemize and write it down. That will make.
At this point, we stopped recording because we wanted to give people time to quietly think while they were writing their system down. And I think we ran out of battery or something, but we had a final round robin where some people shared the system that they were working on. And we had a little bit of back and forth as they got feedback from each other. And then we did our final round robin where we did gems and commitments. So it was a great discussion. I loved having this class. What I'd like to do here at the end is show you those tips if you'd like to apply this to a system that you're drafting for yourself right now. So we did discuss this. You did hear this on the video, but here are some of the things that are really important when adding systems to your daily routine. It works better if you add it onto a routine that already exists. There's many ways to draw or write the system. You can do a list of steps, a flowchart, or a checklist. We talked on the video about not pressuring yourself to do it perfectly, actually working into habits instead of expecting yourself to do it perfectly from the beginning. And we alluded to how bad habits get started more gradually. And so you can sort of look at how you naturally form bad habits and use that as a guideline to help you take the pressure off yourself when it comes to forming good habits. If you do something the same time of day in the same chain of events, it's going to become a habit more quickly. And with anything that drains you, it helps to contain it into smaller and more frequent steps. One of the great things about having everyone stop in the class and spend 5 to 10 minutes actually writing a draft of a system is the fact that they could apply it right away. And that's something that you might want to do right now before you go on to whatever the next thing is you're planning on doing today, is sit down, get some paper, set a timer for 5 minutes if you don't have very much time, and draft out something that you can add to your life to make it more systemized, to give yourself some more energy. Studies have shown that if you apply something that you learn right away, you'll get better results and you'll actually end up using it and benefiting from it. So I would love to hear what you've added to your life as a result of spending the time listening today. I have the benefit of reading progress reports that some of my clients send me, and I've already seen a couple of progress reports where people have shared some of the systems that they're practicing now and putting into action, and I'm so excited to read about those. So I hope you enjoyed the video. Thank you for listening, and we'll see you next time.